But I'm glad you're here this morning at First Service, and as we just continue on the series that we are. And I was reading in this cute little story. It's about a Sunday school teacher that gave a lesson on the Ten Commandments. And when they got done on the Ten Commandments, and that the Sunday school teacher asked the students, "Now, which of the Ten Commandments applies to your relationship with your siblings?" And there was quiet in the room until this little girl in the back brightly replied, "Do not murder." You know, and I think if we've had siblings, some of us might be able to relate to that when it comes to it. Actually, how many of you have ever been in any kind of a relationship? Okay, good. Some of you, you know, didn't put your hands up. I understand that, you know, when it comes to that. But the truth is, we've all had some kind of relationships. We've had relationships with parents, siblings, girlfriends, boyfriends, and all those other kinds of things. And maybe in those relationships, that do not murder could be a good thing. Because relationships, they can be fun, but relationships can be so tough. You know, a lot of the times, one thing, actually not a lot of the times, but one thing that we have in common when it comes to relationships is, or the two things is, we've all had them, and probably all of us have had broken relationships within our lives somehow. And when we have that pain of that broken relationship, a lot of the times what happens is we start to build a wall around ourselves. We build a wall around our heart and everything because we want to block everybody out because we don't like the pain that we went through. So we build this wall and we just cast everybody away. And we've been learning that God says, look, I want you to be happy in life. I love you so much that I want you to be happy in life and blessed in life. And we've been going through this series on the Beatitudes, understanding that he loves us so much that he wants us to be happy. And one of the ways that he created us to be happy is to have relationships. And if we really want to have the relationships the way that God wants us to have the relationships, we got to tear down those walls that we've been building up to protect ourselves so we can really work on the relationships and be in the relationships the way that God wants us to be. I mean, that's actually what we've been studying through this whole series for the last 6 weeks. We've talked about how making different decisions can open up the possibilities that life can be radically different. And today we're going to look at two of the Beatitudes, two of the different Beatitudes. The first one comes from Matthew 5:7 that says this, "Happy are those who are merciful to others." And Matthew 5:9 says, "Happy are those who work for peace." And you might be saying, "Dave, hang on a second. You got the word happy. My translation says blessed." They're the exact same word. Same meaning. You know, you can take blessed are those who are merciful to others. It's the exact same aspect with it. And we're talking about God wants us to be blessed. God wants us to be happy. And one of the ways that we do that is by showing mercy. One of the ways that we do that is by working at peace in our relationships. And that's tough because I know if I were to go around right now and hand out a blank sheet of paper and a pen to everybody and say, I want you to start writing down every, since you can remember, as far back as you can remember, kindergarten before, every hurt that's happened to you, every broken relationship, every wrong that's been done to you, everything, every wound that's ever happened, all the way up to right now as you're sitting here today, just start writing and writing. If you could actually literally remember that, you know, we actually would probably be sitting here till Christ came back because it's just endless of the ways that we have been hurt and maybe the ways that we have hurt each other in these relationships that's caused us to build these walls in our life and cause us not to have the kind of relationships that God wants us to have. But I want us to learn today what our attitude should look like and some steps that we can take in breaking those down. And I want to read from you out of Matthew 18 a story that Jesus tells that helps us understand how we should look at each other and our relationships and treat each other. It's a familiar passage. I'm not going to put it on the screen to read because I just want you to sit there and kind of picture this in your mind, this story unfolding and happening. And if you got to close your eyes to picture it, that's fine. Just no snoring, okay, when it comes to this. So Matthew 18, starting in verse 21, listen to this. This is what it says. At that point, Peter got up the nerve to ask the master, "How many times do I forgive a brother or sister who hurts me? Seven?" Now remember, he thinks he's being extremely gracious here. Jesus replied, "Seven? Hardly. Try 70 times seven." Then he tells the story. "The kingdom of God is like a king who decided to square accounts with his servants. As he got underway, one servant was brought before him who had run up a debt of $100,000. He couldn't pay up, so the king ordered the man, along with his wife, children, and goods, to be auctioned off at the slave market. The poor wretch threw himself at the king's feet and begged, 'Give me a chance, and I'll pay it back.' Touched by this plea, the king let him off, erasing the debt. the servant was no sooner out of the room when he came upon one of his fellow servants who owed him $10. He seized him by the throat and demanded, "Pay up now." The poor wretch threw himself down and begged, "Give me a chance and I'll pay it back." But he wouldn't do it. He had him arrested and put in jail until the debt was paid. When the other servants saw this going on, they were outraged and brought a detailed report to the king. The king summoned the man and said, "You evil servant, I forgave your entire debt when you begged me for mercy. Shouldn't you be compelled to be merciful to your fellow servant who asked for mercy?" The king was furious and put the screws to the man until he paid back the entire debt. And that's exactly what my Father in heaven is going to do to each of us, each of you, if one of you doesn't forgive unconditionally anyone who asks for mercy. And I know when we read a story like this, it can be kind of uncomfortable because Jesus told this story for a reason. He told this story because he wanted to bring change. And we don't like change. But he wanted to bring change. He wanted to bring change in the way that we relate, in the way that we view, in the way that we treat other people in our relationships. So we can show mercy, so we can seek out peace, as those Beatitudes said. And there's a couple things that I want us to be reminded of today. Things that I'm sure you've heard about before. Things that you've probably heard said, taught at different ways and different times. But again, I want us to bring into perspective today and see it. Is this where we really are? Because if we truly want the happiness that Christ says, that God says we can have, are we really doing this then and within our lives? So a couple things. The first is this. The first principle that Jesus shared that, like I said, is so simple is this. Because I've been forgiven, I can forgive. Because you and I have been forgiven, then we are able to forgive. But I know that's tough. It's kind of like these two little brothers, Harry and James. They'd finished their supper and they were playing until bedtime, and somehow Harry hit James with a stick, and the tears and the bitter words started to flow. And accusations and name-calling were still being exchanged as the mother got him ready for bed. And she'd had enough of it, and she finally said, "Now, boys, what would happen if either of you died tonight and you never had the opportunity again to forgive one another?" James spoke up and says, "Well, okay, I'll forgive him tonight. But if we're both alive in the morning, he better look out." And that's how we are with our forgiveness. Okay, I will right now, but, and we hold on to that. And we got to realize, yes, like we just said, we're able to forgive because we've been forgiven. And because we've been forgiven, we're able to forgive. I mean, again, think of the story that I read from Matthew 18 about this. Here's this servant. He has no idea. He's just getting up on a regular day. He has no idea that this day that he wakes up, this particular day, this is going to be judgment day for him. He's bounding out of bed, doing the things he normally does the way that he likes to do it, just going along hunky-dory, and he gets a note. Hey, the king wants to see you. Probably been called before the king many times before, but this time is judgment day. This time he walks into the king, and the king says, "You've got this humongous debt." And I'm sure he was aware of it. The Bible doesn't say how in the world he, you know, got that large of a debt. It just says you got this humongous debt. And then it's pointed before, but the king says something different here. Today, it has to be paid in full. You know, and you can just see this. I can't. You know, and he begs and he pleads for mercy. And as you look at this story, the king, why? I don't know. He just asked for mercy, and the king has pity on him. And this humongous debt that he could never repay of $100,000, he wipes it off the books. He said, "I'm going to treat it like it was never, ever there." And of course, as we look at that, as we talk about this, it's extremely easy for us to understand. This is a story about us and our king, God, our heavenly Father, that we have this debt. From the time that we're born and we come into this world, we have this debt that we owe. We have this debt that we could never, ever repay. Even if we're like this servant that says, just give me a little bit of time, I'll work a little bit harder. I mean, from this point on, if every single one of us in this room kept every single one of the Ten Commandments, if we had the best day, if every day from this point until the day we died, we were smiling, we were good, there wasn't a grumpy day, we were kind, we were generous, we were all these kinds of things, you know what? It wouldn't be enough to pay back our debt. We can't do it. And God forgives us. Why? Why? It's because of Christ. You see, the debt didn't remain unpaid in me. The debt that I owe God didn't remain unpaid. The debt that you owe God doesn't remain unpaid. I couldn't pay it, you couldn't pay it, but Jesus Christ can, and Jesus Christ did. And because of what Jesus did in taking on that debt that I owe, God has mercy on me and he has mercy on you. And he says he'll forgive us. And he says we can come home to that. We can turn to him and we can receive that. You know, there's so many beautiful pictures that we see within Scripture of God's love. You know, we've talked about this how many times this year. If we only knew how much God loved us, we couldn't build a church big enough to really hold back the people that would be coming in those doors because they want to express back that love to God, truly and honestly in that. You know, but there's picture after picture. I mean, one of the most famous stories that we have that show about this mercy and this love of God is the prodigal son. Remember that story? And Rembrandt, he has this painting that's going to be up there that you can see of the prodigal son and that, and that's there. And when you look at that, you see the son kneeling before the father. It's a beautiful picture as we're talking about this love and this mercy and this grace that God has to forgive us, you know, and that here's this prodigal son. We know the story. He takes his inheritance. He runs off. He spends it. He comes back and he says, I'll beg just to be a servant. And when his father sees him off, you know, he goes running to him and he accepts him. And the son, thinking he's going to be accepted as a servant, falls in his father's arms, you know. He's not accepted as a servant. He's welcomed back as a son. That forgiveness and that love, you know. And if you look at the painting close enough, I don't know if you could see where you're at, but his left hand, the father's left hand, is a masculine hand. The right hand is a feminine hand, showing, talking about the justice of God that's there, our Father, who's a just Father, but also a loving and merciful and graceful Father that's willing to welcome us back. And I don't think we see God that way a lot of times. We see God as more like a heavenly, earthly Father, you know. I mean, because what would a lot of fathers do? I mean, think about that. If your parent gave you your inheritance when you turned 18 and you ran out and you partied and you just blew it on everything stupid and idiotic and all that crazy stuff, and then you came back home, would your daddy be like this and welcome home? A lot of dads aren't that way today. A lot of dads are what? I told you so. I told you you were too young, too immature. I told you you couldn't handle it. Going out there, now look at you, your whole inheritance. You ain't got nothing left. And do you know how embarrassed I am because of what you did? Do you know how much you hurt your mom? That's what we expect. And the picture that we see in Scripture is it's not that God's not a just God, but when we turn to God, when we understand, when we're willing to seek out mercy, when we're willing to look for that, he's right there saying, come on home. Here's these steps. Come on home, you know. We have this Father. We have this King who sees this debt that we can't pay. And he hugs us, and he says, come on home. He sees exactly who we are. I've heard it described this way. When I was in Bible college, one of my professors was talking about this way, trying to paint the picture, saying, we got like these deep caves within us. We have these layers upon layers deep within us that's in our soul, you know. It just kind of filled with our wrong, kind of filled with our junk, a lot of garbage that's there. And we keep it so well hidden from each other. I mean, very few of us really honestly knows the depths of ugliness in anyone else's soul. Because we'd be horrified, you know, if the real depths within us could be seen by others. But the thing that we forget is God sees it. God already knows it's there. God sees it. And God does not run from it. He sees those places that are so dark that the days of light don't even hit it. Those places where you struggle, where you hurt, those places where you question, those places where you doubt, you know, he sees where you've cried in agony. He sees it all and he doesn't run, you know. He sees where all of that that's there and he doesn't run because he loves you. And he's giving you grace and he's given mercy on you. And because he's treated you this way and treated us this way, he asks us to turn around and give that to others. So, because I receive mercy and forgiveness from God, I can forgive others, right? I mean, A plus B equals C. God forgives me, so I forgive everybody else. That's exactly how it is in our lives, right? No, it's not, because there's a problem. Because, again, if we got gut level on us, which is a good thing to do when you're at church, especially when we're in the presence of God, is there's a problem. We don't like to forgive. I mean, again, let's get honest. I don't always like to forgive. In my life, you probably don't either, you know. And as I thought about it, this is probably one of the biggest problems I have with my relationships, you know. So instead of it working in the way where God forgives me and I forgive you, it's more typically God forgives me and I'll think about forgiving you if I decide to do that, you know. And that leads to the second principle, the second truth in this passage is this, the unforgiving become the unforgiven. Again, picture the story that we read in Matthew 18 about the servants that are here, okay? This one servant, he receives forgiveness of this great debt, and he's just giddy. He's just bounding out of there all happy. I mean, I would be too if somebody came up to me. I don't have a $100,000 debt, but if somebody walked in this door and said, Dave, all the debt you have, I mean, I'd be pretty giddy right now with it, you know? His debt's been forgiven. He's skipping along, and he sees this guy that owes him 10 bucks. You know, he says, pay up now. And the other guy says, you owe me this. And he says, well, wait, don't do anything. Don't do anything. Just give me time. I'll pay it back. And he says, no, and he throws him in. You're toast. Get out of here. You're going in prison. And again, that gut level honesty I just talked about a couple minutes ago, I probably relate more to that servant that says, no, I'm sorry. Give me the 10 bucks. Get in jail. That's probably more truthfully how we treat each other than we do the way the king is. See, you know, when it comes to my sin, when it comes to my weaknesses, when it comes to my failures, I want mercy. I want grace. I want God to look at me and say, Dave, I realize you've had a bad day. I understand, Dave, you've had a bad day. Dave, I know you got two sons. And making sure he's awake. It was a long night last night for us, you know. Good night. But, you know, Dave, I realize you had a bad day, so, Dave, here's my mercy. Here's my grace. Dave, here's my forgiveness. I want that from God, and I want that from you. When I mess up, when I say things and do things that hurt you, I want you to say, Dave, I know you got two sons. Dave, I know you've had a rough day. Sorry, buddy. I owe you on that one. Shake at McDonald's on me, okay? I know, Dave, you've had a bad day. I know you've had a bad week, Dave. So, Dave, of those words that you said to me that were hurtful, that thing that you did that really hurt me, Dave, I forgive you. I want that from God, and I want that from you. But when it comes to the sin and the woundedness and the failures of people towards me, you know what I want? I want justice. I want revenge. I want you to pay up, you know? I want you to pay me what you owe me. You hurt me. You need to pay. You wounded me. You're going to pay. I'm angry, and I have the right to be angry because of what you did or what you said, and you're going to feel the wrath of David Anthony Beale. So put up or shut up. I mean, seriously, isn't that how we are? You know, what you did was wrong. I'm going to be mad, you know. I'm going to make you pay for it, and if you're not careful, I might bring it up again. It's kind of like all those catalogs of hurts that I talked about at the very beginning on that blank piece of paper that we would, it's like we take in the old Dewey Decimal System. You know, I take in all these hurts and I categorize them. Oh, yeah, I remember. That's 43.1. I remember that hurt. Here it is. And I bring it out again and slap it in your face. I remember when you said that. I remember when you did that. You know, but in the story, the king hears about what this ungrateful servant did and he calls him back. And remember what he said? You evil, wicked man, I forgave this enormous debt, you know, that you could never, ever, ever repay. And you couldn't have a little bit of mercy on your fellow servant who owed you so much less? Why? So he threw him in to be tormented. The version that that I read for you was from the Message paraphrase. It says, he put the screws to him. And I read several different translations and several different commentaries on this, trying to see what they're trying to say. And basically what they're trying to say is, you're going to be in trouble. You're going to be tortured. It is not going to be pleasant. Short within itself that if you're not willing to take the steps and as we said there in the Beatitudes, go after mercy, go after peace. If you're not willing to look at that, there's not going to be happiness. You're actually going to be in a prison of pain is what you're causing if you're not willing to forgive and take the steps and do those and bring that in there, you know? Bring that in. And it can break you. Again, in Matthew 5:7, it says, God blesses those who are merciful, for they will be shown mercy. That's where the blessing, that's where the happiness comes from, when we're able to take those steps. And it's not just taught right here in the Beatitudes. Matthew 6:14 and 15 says, for if you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you don't forgive others their sin, your Father will not forgive you. Mark 11:25, but when you are praying, first forgive anyone that you are holding a grudge against, so that your Father in heaven will forgive your sins too. Stop judging others. then Luke liked that last part of it, so he said in Luke 6:37, stop judging others, and you'll not be judged. Stop criticizing others, for it will come back on you. If you forgive others, you'll be forgiven. And James jumps in James 2:13, for there will be no mercy for you if you have not been merciful to others. But if you have been merciful, then God's mercy towards you will win out over his judgment against you. This tearing down the walls and having our relationships the way that God wants us to have them. That's kind of an important thing, is it not? You can see that's here. I read a quote this week that says, as long as we are unable to forgive, we keep ourselves chained to the unforgiving. We give them rent-free space in our mind, emotional shackles in our heart, and the right to torment us in the small hours of the night. I think, and that if you've ever been around those that like are in a care center that are bedridden or in a wheelchair, they can't get out of it, and you've been around them or had a relative or friend or whatever, you know, one of the things that they're always on the watch for is a thing called bed sores. You know, bed sores develop if you're sitting there in the same spot and or whatever, and they can be a dangerous thing because they don't look bad. When you first look at them and see them, they don't look bad. They just look like this little bump or whatever that's there. But all the while, underneath the surface, they might look good on the surface, but underneath the surface, they're eating away at healthy tissue. And if they're not stopped, they'll eventually get down to the bone and eat at the bone. And sepsis will set in if you're not taking care of it. And sometimes it can get so bad, the only way is to do a radical surgery to bring healing. And then once that's done, if the healing happens, then you've got to always be extra careful of that area because it becomes weak and dangerous. You know, within our lives. And I'm afraid that this wall that we build up, this unforgiveness, this bitterness, this resentment becomes like those bed sores in our lives. We look good on the out. It's real easy to walk in here this morning and greeting time, hey, how you doing, shaking hands and put that little smiley face on right now, you know, because things for the most part look good, because for the most part we're living right, but we've got this little spiritual bed sore that's working on us. And if we're not taking the steps that we need to be taking, if we're not doing that, then this resentment, this anger, this hostility that you feel that you deal with, you know, we'll just keep, and we just try to keep covering up, we'll start eating. We'll spiritually start eating to the point that our relationships will start dissolving. And you'll be standing there one day and all of a sudden someone will come and say, I'm done. I'm done with our friendship. You're out of my life, I'm out of yours. I'm done with this marriage. You're out of my life, I'm out of yours with it. All because, you know, the main reason is because we have this unforgiving attitude that we don't really realize, you know, what that entails within our life. And God says, look it, you want to have happiness? You want to have blessings? Then it's time. It's time to start forgiving because you have been forgiven much. So it's time to start turning around on that list, however long it is, on those people that are there, and to forgive them in that. You've been forgiven a debt that you can't repay. C.S. Lewis said this, to be a Christian means to forgive the inexcusable because God has forgiven the inexcusable in you. So we need to learn to become a forgiver. We need to learn as a forgiver, and that's what's going to tear down these walls. And I know you're sitting there saying, that's tough, Dave, because it's still pretty raw. This thing, that this bitterness or this frustration or this hurt that I have, it's really fresh. It just happened last night, last week, last month, whatever. It's still pretty fresh and pretty raw. I understand that. But that doesn't mean we stop taking steps towards healing. You know, I mean, you get a gash on your arm and it's cut wide open. Do you wait? I mean, you can cut it right down and you can see the bone. You sit around and go, well, I'm going to wait before I go to the doctor because it's just too painful right now. And, you know, just too much blood. And I don't want to face it right now. I don't want to deal with it. So maybe in a week or two or three or a month, I'll go taking this. But right now, it's just too raw. No, we don't do that. What do? You go in immediately to the doctor that can heal you. And that's what I want to encourage. The worship team is going to come back up here and lead us to continue to sing to this God that loves us in ways that wants us to be happy. But I want to encourage you and challenge you to be this forgiver. And you say, I don't know how to do that. Good. I want to give you two things real quick, like, that can at least start you down that road. Start taking the steps in the right direction. If you want to be a forgiver, if you want to bring healing into your life, if you want to get rid of the bed sores, whatever metaphor you want to stick with that works on your heart here this morning, if you want to have that blessed life, if you want to be able to give mercy to others and seek out peace, no matter what's been done to you, you want to be able to do that because so much has been given to you, then here's the first thing you need to do. You need to metaphorically nail it to the cross. take the wound, take the unforgiveness, take the bitterness, and figuratively nail it to the cross of Christ. The one who paid your debt is the one that can give you the strength to handle this, you know? In Matthew 18, servant didn't have another chance, you know? When he found out, he was thrown in prison in there to do that. Right now, as long as our bodies are sucking in air and we're alive and we're in everything, while we're on this side of eternity, we have a chance to take these steps, to nail it to the cross, to take these steps to work on mercy, to take these steps to have peace. Once this body that I'm in right now, this tent, as Scripture says, once it decides and it's no more and I have to lay this tent aside so I can go before God, I have no more chances. So there's no better time to nail it to the cross, which brings me to the second step, to start it, and to start it right now, start it today. To start it today within our life, you know? We can begin to have a grateful heart first. God, I want to tell you again how thankful I am that you took the steps that you did to forgive me, that you made the way that you did for me to have eternal life with you. God, I am so grateful and so thankful that you came into my life and you made a way for my life with this unpayable debt I have, and you paid it for me. Thank you for that. That's a first step that we take, you know? But then I need to be willing to turn right around to everybody that's in my life, that's ever hurt me, you know, that's ever done anything against me, and that I'm 53 years old today, and that, and, you know, I can guarantee you I've done some stupid things and I've hurt people in my life, you know, and I've had some people, I'm going to watch how I say it, I've had some people in my life hurt and say, and do stupid things to me, you know, when it comes to that aspect with it. Some of it I held on for a long, long time, you know, long time. 18. I was 18. Had something pretty nasty happen when I was 18. I held on to that clear into my marriage and stuff like that, and how I would treat people and other people that even looked or sounded like this person that when I was 18. It was completely unfair to them because they didn't do anything. If you walked into my life and you looked and sounded like this person at 18, I judged you, and I disliked you very, very strongly, and you might not even have to say a word to me. In one sense, sometimes you could just look like it and act like it, you know. So it's tough. Start today to bring that freedom into our life, to bring your freedom into that life, to have that happiness. I can't tell you how happy I was been and how happy my life has been since I got rid of that one, and that's just one in my life. And I know there's probably all of us in here, like I said, one thing we have in common, or two things we have in common. We have relationships, and we have broken relationships. And I want to give you the chance here. We're going to pray, and that, and if you're looking in your life, and as we've been talking about relationships, and we're talking about making a list, and you're thinking, yeah, this name popped up, or this incident popped up, and you realize, I really haven't. You kind of start feeling a little bit of frustration. Maybe you really haven't given the forgiveness, or shown the mercy, or tried to work out the peace that it said in Matthew there 5:9. You know, try to work out that peace in the life. Maybe you haven't done that. Then why not today? Why not start today? And if you're sitting there saying, Dave, I've tried, I just can't. Amen, you're in the right place. You can't. That's what God's trying to tell you. You can't. You can never forgive someone the way that Christ wants you unless you have Christ in you. That's the only way. Unless you surrendered your life and said, okay, God, I can't do it. Only you through me can do that. Only your love through me. And that's committing your life to Christ. Maybe that's the starting point today that you need to take, to 100% surrender, or 100% recommit to that, so you can have that strength that can help you take that step to show that mercy, whatever it is. And I don't know. But I want us to take time and pray. And then we're going to be singing. And that, and if there is a commitment you want, if you just want your family praying so you can start taking those steps today, I'll be up front. Come on up here with me, and we'll celebrate life together. But let's go before God. Lord, I thank you. I thank you, Father God, that you want us to have that happiness. I thank you for that blessing, and I thank you for the path that you've shown us that we need to walk, to go after mercy, to go after seeking peace at all costs with anybody that it's possible, as long as it is as capable, possibly, and we're capable of doing that, Father. And Lord, I pray for the wisdom and strength to know what that looks like within our life. I thank you that you've shown us that, Father God, and I pray now, as your Holy Spirit just seeks out our heart and searches our heart, help us to see, is there a stronghold that we have given in our heart because we haven't taken those steps, because we've not sought after mercy, because we've not taken the steps for peace, because we've forgotten how much we've been forgiven? And so we've been forgiven so much, how much we need to turn around and forgive. Father, I pray for that light to be shown and made known within our lives, starting today, and then your wisdom and your strength to start taking those steps, whatever that may be, Father, so we can receive the blessings we read about, that you taught about so many years ago on that mount, Father God. Again, we thank you this time we can be in your presence and experience and understand and be refreshed and be reminded, Father God, of a truth of how much you love us and the blessings that can be there when we turn to you, when we surrender to you, Father. Thanks so much for that. Now just hear our voices as we continue to sing out to you. It's in Jesus Christ's name.